Good afternoon, everyone. How's everyone today? A great crowd we have today. We are officially getting started for the photographers. Make sure the mics are on, the lights are on. What a fantastic crowd. A lot of dignitaries. I can tell you what, when you have these many dignitaries in one place and just a bunch of great folks, you just never know who made that call to have this kind of day to celebrate 20 years, right? So let's give them a round of applause. I'm Jason Hill with Austin Water. Honored to be here. 20 years of the BCCP. We're celebrating all the accomplishments that have happened during the past 20 years. Each one of you most likely being intimately involved in some aspect of it. And also coming together today looking towards the future and the next 20 years. I'd like to acknowledge a few people that are here that won't be speaking, but that are here. Former Travis County Commissioner Bristol. Former County Commissioner Karen Sunlightner. Director of Austin Water, Greg Mazaris. Mayor of Lakeway, Joe Bain. We have from Ted Cruz's office, Deputy Regional Director from there. State Senator Paul Workman, staff member Daniel Werner is here as well. Also, former Division Manager of Wildlands for Austin Water, Willie Conrad, made his way here today too. Always a pleasure to see him. We're gonna start things off with a very distinguished speaker that we have here, Michael J. Bean. He's the Principal Deputy Assistant Secretary for Fish and Wildlife and Parks at the Department of Interior, all the way in from Washington, D.C. In this role, he is responsible for providing policy direction and oversight to the National Park Service and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. Prior to joining the Interior back in 2009, he served as head of the Wildlife Program of the Environmental Defense Fund, where he became known as a leading authority on the Endangered Species Act, and in particular, one of the use of incentives to engage private landowners in conserving rare species. This man has done a lot of work. He's come a long way. We are honored to have him here today. Michael Bean.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you, audience. It's been a great pleasure to be here. It's part of this celebration of this wonderfully successful conservation plan, the Balcones Canyonlands Conservation Plan. When I asked the organizers of this event who I should single out for thanks for this successful effort, I was told there are just too many people to fit into a five-minute speech. So let me just thank everyone who's been involved, starting with the Riker Ranch here for hosting this fine event, and including my colleague here who's about to speak, Councilmember Leslie Poole. When I was told there are too many people to thank individually, what that told me was this has been a remarkably cooperative, collaborative effort that has involved people from all different organizations, all different places in the county, in the city, and so forth. And that is a testament to the strength of this plan, that it has united so much of Austin, so much of Travis County. I think when this plan was put together, it being Texas, the idea was to think big. And what this plan reflects is a conscious effort to take a look at the larger landscape, the Hill Country landscape, the landscape that it has brought people to Austin and to Travis County over the years, making it one of the fastest growing regions in the country. And recognizing that part of the reason that these people are coming here is because of the unique setting in which they can live, the unique environment, the unique opportunities for outdoor recreation and so forth that the Hill Country provides. By the early 1990s, it was quite clear that the growth of the city and the county were bumping up against some of the constraints with respect to the environment. And the county and the city came together to put together a far-reaching plan, one that tried to balance the need for development with the need for conservation. And they succeeded because the city has continued to grow, the county's continued to grow, and in the meantime, a wonderful preserve system has been established that provides opportunities for young people and others to experience the outdoors, to learn about nature, to retain some of the essential character of the Hill Country. And I think that is a testament of this plan. It's really served as a model for many other similar plans throughout the country that have come along more recently. So I want to thank all of you who have been involved in this for the last two decades for your leadership in establishing a truly progressive, enlightened, thoughtful, balanced plan. And I want to take note of the fact that you're 20 years through the 30-year duration of this permit that made this plan possible. I want to encourage you to begin thinking about the years beyond the 30-year term so as to ensure that the great successes you've accomplished for conservation, for outdoor education, for preserving the environment can continue. So again, thank you very much for the opportunity to be part of your celebration today. On behalf of Secretary of Interior Sally Jewell, I want to assure you that she too is most impressed with what you've accomplished here today and joins me in wishing you success for the future. Thank you.
Michael J. Bean, thanks again. All the way from the nation's capital. He's not going to be able to stay a long time. Unfortunately, he won't be able to enjoy some Franklin's barbecue. But he's gotten some good old-fashioned camaraderie here with us today. Thanks again for joining us. I'd like to invite next to the podium Austin Council member Leslie Poole. She is currently the co-chair of the Balcones Canyonlands Conservation Plan. Councilwoman Poole. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, there's hardly room for my little piece of paper. Well, I really appreciate being here today to celebrate with everybody. And at council yesterday, I was so privileged to be able to offer a 20-year anniversary certificate to all of the folks and to who had joined in to make this plan a success over the last 20 years. A couple of folks that I wish had been there weren't able to be there, and he's sitting right here in front of me today, Mr. Willie Conrad. He has carried the mantle for this plan and this preserve for a long time. He shepherded it from the very beginning, and we sure owe you a debt of gratitude, Willie. Thank you so much. So I appreciate everyone being here today to celebrate this historic milestone and to recognize the importance of the BCCP to Austin and Travis County communities. It's an excellent example of what can be achieved when people work together in a spirit of cooperation and look for that win-win that we all need to find when we're looking for solutions. And I think some of the comments that Michael Bean just made about the conservation and the development and coming to find some balanced perspectives and where everybody wins in that is something that I am working really hard to achieve in other issues in my role as a council member with the city. Austin has seen tremendous growth since 1996, and this plan has enabled us to balance economic development with environmental protection, and the two of those deserve to be balanced. In 1996, the city and the county committed to the BCCP and created the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve to protect a minimum of 30,428 acres of endangered songbird habitat, plus 62 caves for endangered cave invertebrates. Today, at the 20th anniversary, we can proudly celebrate that we have achieved the acquisition of, and with the help of Travis County real estate folks, and I see Junie Plummer here with the City of Austin, with her efforts, the acquisition of 31,785 acres for the benefit of the golden-cheeked warbler and black-capped vireo, and protection of 48 of the 62 karst features. So as always, we still have work to do, but boy, we've achieved a lot in two decades. The BCCP permit provides a cost-effective, certain, streamlined permitting process for the development community. Development permitted through the BCCP has brought 6.3 billion, with a B as they say, in assessed value to the local tax base. The Balcones Canyonlands Preserve also provides important water quality, air quality, and open space benefits to our community. The preserve serves as a living laboratory for universities and researchers from across the nation who come here to study the area's unique native wildlife. The preserve also provides important experiences in nature for thousands of students and the public every year through educational activities and guided hikes by all of the BCP partners. We also have a number of volunteers who dedicate thousands of hours assisting with habitat restoration and greatly extend the ability of BCP partner staff. In fact, if I could just say, I don't think we could do as much as we do without our community and the volunteers in our community in most of the endeavors that we undertake at both the county and the city levels. So, okay, let's talk about the future of the BCCP. Our permit will expire in 10 years. And our city and county political leaders will be faced with the decision of whether to renew the permit to continue the streamed line approach to development in Travis County. And you know what? That's an easy decision for me to make, and I hope for all of you as well. Of course, we will work to extend the permit and ensure the streamlined approach to development in Travis County. But to be in good standing to renew, the permit conditions will have to be met. So we will need to find creative approaches to completing those requirements. The tremendous growth of our community brings challenges to the future management of the preserve system. In 1996, the preserve was largely surrounded by rural land. Today, it is almost completely surrounded by development. This urban growth impacts the preserve with urban runoff, providing edge habitat for predators. And it's a source of invasive plant species as well. Many newcomers to Austin want to increase recreation on the preserve and don't understand the need to manage foremost for endangered species conservation. Our traffic challenges also bring pressure to put roads across the preserve lands. The BCP provides mitigation for all of the development outside of the preserve, so we must manage it carefully so that we don't see a decline in the populations of the species that we need to protect. We must continue the strong public-private partnership of the BCCP well into the future to ensure its continued success. This is truly one of the success stories that make Austin such a special place to live. I thank you all for being here today, and I will turn you back over to Jason Hill. Thank you.
Councilwoman Leslie Poole. And our next speaker, Travis County Judge Sarah Eckhart. She has been a leader in our area addressing major issues that face Travis County. She works to ensure that the community is green, healthy, just, and mobile. Please join me in welcoming Judge Eckhart.
Thank you so much. And my staff called me Judge Magoo because I have a tendency to show up late because I'm looking at things. It's like, oh, look at the pretty flowers. And I'm driving slow. I made it all the way up to Hudson Bend before I went, I think maybe I passed my mom. Yeah. But it's really great to be here. It's an honor to be here. And it's going to be the highlight of my day being out here in the Hill Country on a beautiful Friday afternoon. I'm going over to the Shield Ranch tomorrow for a hike. So that's a great way to celebrate Mother's Day. I'm really honored to be standing here among so many environmental heroes in the audience. Environmental heroes who have spoken today. Very honored to be here with Secretary Bean. Humbled to stand on the shoulder of giants like Valerie Bristol. Karen Suntliner. Karen, are you around here? There's Karen. There you are right there. David Escamilla, who helped draft the document that is the agreement. Judge Bisco, who was on the Commissioner's Court then, Judge Aylshire, who was the judge at the time, Kevin Conley, Wendy Conley, John Cool, Sherry Cool, it's a family affair, clearly, Rose Farmer, who's back there, Willie Conrad, John White, Melinda Mollier, so many people who made this possible. And a big thanks, of course, to Bruce Babbitt, who at the signing ceremony said, 50 years from now, our children and grandchildren are going to look back and say, how is it that they had the foresight to do this sort of thing? It's as powerful in this time as the creation of Central Park was in another century. We owe a great debt to Secretary Babbitt for getting us beyond the us versus them paradigm and getting us to a place of balance between the man-made world and the natural world. Acknowledging that the man-made world depends on the natural world, and that to the man-made world and the natural world can exist in the same space and even enrich each other. And I know Commissioner Daugherty is not able to be here today, but I do want to mention we have numbers that prove up that enrichment. We have, if you need proof of the enrichment of living in the same space with the natural world, we need only look at the property values adjacent to the Balcones Canyon Land Preserve. On average, properties adjacent to the preserve are at least 20% more valuable in the market than comparable properties. But I'll say, Bruce Babbitt really underplayed it when he compared us to Central Park. Central Park is a mere 843 acres. It's a smudge on the map, really. Blink and you've missed it. Whereas the mighty Balcones Canyon Land Preserve can be seen from space at 30,000 acres. Melinda gave me this stat. She said, can you believe that when you look at satellite imagery, the definition, the boundaries of the Balcones Canyon Land Preserve are clearly defined by the intense wash of the light of development that defines its parameters. Also, something we have over Central Park. Central Park is not home to endangered species. Although it is home to some rare birds of extraordinary foliage, of extraordinary plumage. I can say that because I lived there for 12 years. So we have two goals in the future, and I know that Leslie touched on this. There are two goals for the future that for the Balcones Canyon Land Preserve that I pledge to prioritize. And of course, we will need the help of all of the brain trust that is out here today and so many others. They're linked goals. One is to make the Balcones Canyon Land Preserve so beloved, both by the Travis County residents and also the state, the nation, and the international community, that the Balcones Canyon Land Preserve will be as recognized nationally and internationally as Central Park is. It will be part of the fabric of who we are, that not only will the satellite imagery from space recognize it, but our community itself will recognize the role that it has played in striking that balance between the man-made world and the natural world. So I look to us to find ways to preserve it, to celebrate it, to expand upon it through nature hikes, bird watching, educational programs, even the possibility of managed hunts. We have a huge environmental community that doesn't like to call themselves environmentalists, they like to call themselves hunters. Through media and art about the wildlands. But the second goal, which is inextricably linked to it, is to keep our promise to balance the man-made world with the natural world by protecting the BCCP from any and all loss. Leslie touched on it, and it's something that is ever present to us. Did I leave a page off of my notes? No, there they are. People forget, and we must continually educate them, that the Balcones Canyon Land Preserve was set aside, this habitat was set aside for the destruction of other habitat. We sacrificed other endangered species habitat to development, and we paid for that by laying this aside. The area that we now see ablaze in those lights from satellite imagery in the Texas Hill Country was made possible through that sacrifice. We must never double dip on it. We must never forget the sacrifice or abuse this amazing resource for our own enjoyment, convenience, or profit. We must never abuse this phenomenal 30,000 acre preserve for our enjoyment, convenience, or profit. Because the Balcones Canyonland Preserve is for future generations of people and critters to know and love one another. And I really, really am so honored to be here today.
Judge Eichhardt, you were right on time. Just a note. Right on time. We were sweating, though. Right on time. 20 years, so much work done, so much more work to do. Before we conclude this official part of today's celebration, I'd like to bring up the new, recently named division manager of Wildlands at Austin Water, Sherry Cool.
Thanks, everyone. I'm really honored to be here. I think everyone here has played a part in this 20-year legacy that we have for the community of Travis County and Austin, Texas, and this wonderful tool that we have to enable development and also have enough space to preserve the rare and endangered species that we're blessed with here in the Hill Country. So I just wanted to give a shout out to everyone that came today to help us with this recognition of the BCCP, and also to all the staff who work day in and day out on the plan and really make it happen, and all of our volunteers. We have a lot of volunteers here today, and we have a lot of staff who have helped put this event together. And I want to especially recognize Amanda Ross for all that she did. Cue up Amanda Ross. Hopefully she's around. There she is. Come on up. So Amanda was really our master of ceremonies for this event, and it was months and months in the planning. So we wanted to recognize you. Turn it back over to Jason. Thank you.
Thanks, Sherry. One more round of applause for Sherry. Our speakers. And yourselves, don't forget. Come on. Good to see Willie Conrad. Good to see Willie Conrad. A couple of household items. There is a cool frame with BCCP on the bottom. You can take some selfies. Selfies are in style these days. Also, there's a signage up piece of paper. Please sign your name along that. I think that's going to be something that'll be put up around Riker Ranch somewhere, so it's going to be very cool. Also, we couldn't have had all the speakers here. We would have been here all day, tomorrow, the weekend. So we're going to have a non-official session where folks are going to come up, led by former Commissioner Karen Sunlighter, who's going to kind of bring up folks who have had personal experiences, and they're going to talk about those personal experiences while the rest of us either listen or kind of mill around and enjoy the ranch. Again, give yourselves a warm round of applause. 20 years, exciting 20 more years ahead of us, right? Come on, you guys, really. Thank you so much for coming out. Karen, come on up.
Hopefully I can keep you here for just a couple of minutes before you scatter. I don't know if I can ever see the Balcones from space, but every single one of us can see it if we fly in on any major airline coming in from the west. And I do remember vividly when I was fixing to leave the commissioner's court, we were going out to see the new Starflight helicopter, and we took it out west because we all wanted to go out to the lake. And the people that were flying along with us said, what a shame, as we're getting over by the Oasis. What a shame. Some point, this is all going to be developed. And I said, oh, Time out. Let me tell you about the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve and Conservation Plan. And they were stunned to hear that what they were seeing, this was 2006, so 10 years ago, was not going to change. And it was always one of a community-wide effort. Now, with that said, I was here 20 years ago for the signing ceremony. And when that challenge was put out to us, we need to put it together. We've got 30 years, but the reality is we really only had 20 years because if we didn't get working quickly, we would have those lands that we needed lost to development. And we had to get hustling on this. And I know I was sitting there going, we're going to try our darndest. And there were people in the audience that flat out thought we were going to fail. But we were intent on proving them wrong. But it became very quickly clear after that beautiful signing ceremony on this property that we needed money from the federal government. The city of Austin, through bonds, was putting up money. Travis County was putting up money through the tax increment financing. There were mitigation dollars coming in. But we needed more, and it was federal dollars that we needed. And so an effort was made. Commissioner Todd Baxter and myself and Jackie Goodman, who's city council member, we all pulled together a ragtag group of folks to go to Washington, D.C. and go see our elected representatives up there. And Dave Frederick, who used to be head of U.S. Fish and Wildlife here, was instrumental in getting us an audience with Interior because we were trying to get a federal grant, get our foot in the door on a federal grant off cycle. And that's just not done, but we were bound and determined to do it. And we took up representatives from the Real Estate Council, Chamber of Commerce, environmentalists, representative of landowners, land planners, as I said, Commissioner Baxter, myself, Jackie Goodman. And we had 14 meetings on the Hill in 2 days. Now, of course, it had to be more complicated than that because we almost didn't get there. We are all loaded on airplanes, and we get stuck on the tarmac here in Austin, and there's a rain delay. We get our rain delay, and we miss our flight connection in Dallas. There are no more flights to Washington, D.C., and we have meetings beginning the next morning at 8 o'clock. And so we finally caught a plane to Baltimore that left at 11 o'clock in the evening. We get into Baltimore, have to rent a car, squish 7 people in one of the cars. You're already figuring this out that luggage was disconnected from the people involved here. But fortunately, Todd and I, being the anal retentive persons that we are, we took everything we needed on board with us. So I had all the briefing books to go to Capitol Hill and clothing. Todd had everything that he needed. We split up the briefing books. And it turns out that the next morning, there were people who did not have the proper clothing to go to lobby on Capitol Hill. One of our members had to borrow a bellman's outfit from the hotel. Another one of my dear friends, Thais Austin, she had to contact a relative who lived on a military base and get his wife to quickly run in a dress so that she also could make these things. But we did it. We got 3 hours of sleep, did 10 meetings that first day, 4 the next day, and believe it or not, we were able to change minds there, and it began a series of lobbying efforts up in D.C. to try and get them to understand what our plan was all about. And in the first couple of years, it was a sales pitch. But then it was returning back year after year to show them the return on investment. Here's what we did with the grant money, the Section 6 monies that we got. And I'm very pleased that so many of the people that I may have been the public face up there, but there's Joe Gieselman, Charles Berg, John Cool has been mentioned, Cliff Ladd, Rose Farmer, Terry Siegenthaler, what are you doing here? This is great. I'm seeing so many wonderful, wonderful people that were a part of that effort with the information, the maps, to be able to take our story up to them. And we had a little bit of concern when we changed out administrations. It wasn't Secretary Babbitt anymore. We were moving over to the Bush administration coming in, and there was a swap out of people that we were going to have to see would our story still continue to be told, and would they continue to help us out. And I was never more pleased to find out that my new contact in Washington, D.C. was from Austin, Texas, because David P. Smith, thankfully, took a job with the Department of Interior, and that's who I got to go up and talk to every single year about balconies. And that's who I'd like to bring up to the front right now to visit with.
Thank you, Karen, for that that great intro. And it's I've spent the last couple of weeks, and especially this week, kind of reflecting and thinking about the BCCP, my experience with the BCCP. I've only been working, and I think I'm a relative newcomer because I've only been working on the BCCP for about 22 years in one form or fashion. And it started, I'm one of the anomalies these days in town because I was actually born in Austin. I did move away before I was 1 year old to Southern California with my family, but ended up in Dallas and then got back here as soon as I could for law school, and I've been here in one shape or form pretty much ever since. But I, as a young attorney in 1994, was on the, and with a young attorney, and we're, I think every most people here who've been here for a while remember we were coming out of the good old RTC, Resolution Trust days, and we're starting to rebound economically from a real estate perspective. And I was a kid who wanted to do environment, natural resource and land use work. And so I was a member of RECA and got put on the Endangered Species, RECA Endangered Species Committee, where we were all trying to figure out, okay, we get the Endangered Species Act, but what's this administration? And we've been doing bird letters for a long time. Adam remembers bird letters, and I'm glad we got away from that. But everyone's trying to say, okay, so what's the catch here with this regional habitat conservation plan? Because we get Section 10, we get doing habitat conservation plans on a property by property basis, but what's the catch here with this big picture regional habitat conservation plan? And I will tell you that through a lot of persistence and a lot of people's hard work, a plan came together. And it's I was comparing it a little bit. So like Karen said, fast forward a few years, and I was Deputy Assistant Secretary of Interior for Fish, Wildlife, and Parks, which is the hallway that my longtime friend Michael Bean now is in charge of. I got a call from Todd Baxter, who I knew from my law school days, and Todd says, yeah, we're coming up to meet you, and all these people are coming up and everything else. And I heard only a little bit about some of the fiascos, but everyone came in and started saying, okay, here's what the BCCP is, here's how it operates, here's what vision is. I go, I know, isn't it great? And they're kind of looking at me like, okay. But it helped that I already had been immersed and was already part of the process and was already a believer in the vision, the goal, and what it was trying to achieve. It also helped that we're also in, two things really helped. One thing it helped is from a budgetary standpoint, the federal government was in a place where it could, and the Bush administration was very, very aggressive about funding Section 6 grants, particularly on the land acquisition side. The other thing that this community did exceedingly well was put their money where their mouth was. And really through bond efforts on both the county level and the city level, have acquisition money on hand that then from a federal standpoint, we were able to match up. One of the other benefits I had, and I'm really sorry I can't be here today, is Sam Hamilton, who was a very, very close friend of mine. The whole time I was in D.C., would always remind me. He'd always remind me of the commitment that the service made to this community and not to forget it. And so there was a partnership there between the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and the Travis County and the city of Austin that continued. And, you know, one of the things about being a first child and first of its kind like the BCCP is, you know, there's things as a parent or as an aunt or an uncle that, you know, you probably do over again a little bit differently, and there's mistakes you made. But the reason why the BCCP, in my opinion, has been such a success is because it's not just about the words on the page. It's about the people here, and it's about the people who every day work on it, and it's about the community that supports it, and it's about what it means to this community. And you know, everyone who's come here to talk about it has touched on this, but I really want to emphasize that yes, it was about endangered species and preserving endangered species habitat, but it's also about preserving what makes Austin special. It is about clean water, and it's about clean air and air quality and all the things that make this part of the world wonderful, and part of the reason why I'm glad that I live here in Austin and not in Washington, D.C. anymore and don't have to wear a tie when I come and speak at things like this. So I want to thank all of y'all for everything you've done. I want to thank all of y'all for being here today, and I am proud and blessed to be a part of it. Also, the other thing that happened as a product was Karen was my unofficial lifeline to Austin, and it got to where I would look forward to her coming up every year, because there were actually one thing that was really, really important and a couple other things that were equally as important. Whenever Karen would come up, I had an arrangement with her that, and this was before the days of Amazon and before the days of a lot of other things, and it was back in the days when, do you remember KGSR would put together the Sounds of Austin soundtrack CDs? Every year I say, Karen, please, please, please go and get me the latest KGSR. I think you had to go to either there or to Waterloo to buy them. I said, bring it up and I'll, you know, and I'll reimburse you for it. And so I'd get that every year, which was awesome. And then the other two things is I would hear about the restaurant scene in Austin. And also, because we talk about hot sauce, live music, and then I'd also stay current on all the local political stuff, which was always a lot of fun. So Karen kept me sane in a lot of ways, because I originally went up to D.C. thinking I'd be there for 2 years, ended up staying six. But I can't tell you how proud I am of being a small part of it. And you know, I'm happy that you know, even in a Republican administration, the fact that you're from Austin and understand Austin and have the same conservation values as Austin, being able to make a difference meant the world to me. So thank all of you all for your efforts, and thank you for letting me be here. Thank you, Karen, for everything.
Thank you, everybody, from coming from so far away, and for all our local folks, thanks again for coming out. Guided tours, selfies with the frame, the refreshments. Make sure you drink up. Sun's getting a little bit hot. There are refreshments over here. Thank you again. Safe travels.